Welcome to the podcast of Data and Analytics in Business. We'll learn from the leading industry experts using data and analytics to solve the problems and create values in practice. We'll also learn where the industry is heading to and how data and analytics will shape the industry in the future. Most importantly, how they are preparing their business for digital transformation and disruption in the future. I'm your host, Jason Tan, and thank you for listening. In this episode, we have got Mitchell Trigot. Mitchell is the CEO and co-founder of Airbyte. It is a new open source data integration platform that syncs data from application, API, and databases to data warehouses. Not only Airbyte is a graduate from the Y Combinator, after just 5 months, they have raised $5.2 million in seed funding from SL, 8VC, Y Combinator, and some of the very high-profile business angels, including the co-founder of Segment, the former GM of Caldera, and the co-founder of LiveRAM and Safeguard. With a deep domain expertise in data engineering for the past 15 years, Michelle certainly knows the space of the integration and data engineering. Prior to founding Airbyte, Michelle was the director of engineering at LiveCamp, where he grew the team responsible for building and scaling the data ingestion and distribution connectors. Michelle shared some of his experience, how he built his career as a software engineer and used that as a foundation to become an entrepreneur and starting his own company. But more than that, we spent a lot of time talking about Airbyte, what Airbyte is built for, who are the people Airbyte is built for, and what they can do with Airbyte. Michelle and his co-founder John have some great vision for Airbyte, where they see and build Airbyte as an open source data integration platform, which he went into the details and shared with me and you about why open source platform is the way to go. While Airbyte is still less than 12 months after they have pivoted, the future for Airbyte is actually really, really bright. This is because Airbyte, built by Mitchell and John, is really going to be there to serve the needs for you into connecting and moving a lot of the external data into your data warehouse. How you can bring in and integrate all of this external data to build a better picture about your customer, about your staff, about the services that you are providing. The directions of having it as an open source platform is going to help Airbyte growing and building much more connectors in a very short time. With those connectors in place, you're going to be able to bring so much more external data into your organization very, very quickly without having to fuss around in building it yourself. Data engineering director who have been getting so many requests from your business unit that they want to bring the external data, such as the Facebook data, the Google Ads advertising spend data, or even perhaps the usage of the Zoom video meeting, all of this data that previously are not so accessible, but having all of this data will allow your business unit to understand what is the real CLTV, what is the real net margin for your customer, where and how your staff are spending their time with all of this video call meeting will allow your business unit to have a better picture as an organization. Then this is the episode that you do not want to miss. If you like this episode and have got questions for me and Michelle, feel free to send us a message or connect with us on LinkedIn. Make sure you subscribe at your favorite podcast platform, because clicking the like and subscription will help us to rank better on the platform. Will certainly encourage us to continue to deconstruct how data science analytics are being used to run a high-performing modern organization. I'm your host, Jason Tian, and I hope you enjoyed this episode. Hello, Michelle. Welcome to the Analytics Show podcast. How are you today?
Hi, Jason. Very good. And you?
I am very good. Thank you so much for coming on to the Analytics Show podcast. I'm super excited to talk about some of the works that you guys are doing at the Airbyte. But let's start with a little bit light and to talk about how you started as a software engineer and became an entrepreneur. So at what point did you decide to establish your own technology company?
I basically started my career in 2007. I've always been in the data world, started with financial data. Initially, it was in Paris in 2011. That was my first real startup experience. I joined back in the day a very small startup called LiveRamp. Now it's a public company. And I stayed there for I went from the small startup to the hyper growth of the company. It was a very enlightening experience. And over there, I studied as a senior engineer, and then I became a director of engineering and head of integration. And basically what we were doing was, how do we integrate LiveRamp with all the marketing and ad tech ecosystem? How do we make sure that data can flow through for LiveRamp? And we build thousands of connectors. We're moving hundreds of terabytes of data. And after I left LiveRamp, I actually joined another early stage startup called RideOS, which was more geared toward getting data from autonomous vehicle and doing mapping technologies. And there, what I've noticed is I was doing the same thing I was doing at LiveRamp, which is, how do you build a data pipeline? How do you get data from all these different places? And the data is siloed across so many services. So at that point, it became more I want to use my time to make sure that I solve a problem that everybody is facing. And that's when I started. I actually left RideOS July 4th, 2019. And I started my quest of becoming an entrepreneur and all the good things that go with it. But the root is really solving a problem that every single company is facing today, and where a lot of time and human time is being spent on.
I love it. I think especially the experience that you have got in the LiveRamp and also the other startup, I think it seems to have a really great foundation of helping you to do what you are doing at this new company. I do want to ask you, though, for the software engineer who aspire want to become an entrepreneur, what is the difference that you would tell them that between working for other people and building your own company, while this memory is still very, very fresh in your head?
So first of all, I think we're always working for someone, whether it's working for a company or working on building your own company, because at the end of the day, you're always working for your users, people that are using your product. But I would say the main difference is, when you start a company, you start from nothing. There is no infrastructure around you. You have everything that needs to be done. But unfortunately, we have finite amount of time and finite amount of attention. So at that point, there is a lot more emphasis on actually surrounding yourself with people and brilliant people that can actually be amazing at things that you might not be. And it's basically bootstrapping how you build a structure of your organization, of your company. And I would say that there is human aspect of it is even more important than when you're working at a company, because you are bootstrapping something. So you need to trust the people you're bootstrapping it with. And you need to empower them also to make their own choice and their own decisions. So ensuring that everybody is aligned. And I would say that's the biggest difference. It's a mistake on someone has a higher cost than when you're working for someone else or when you're in a larger organization.
I so agree with that. And following on that, I suppose equally for the software engineer role, and then you step up to, i.e. from the software engineering background, and then you step up to become the CEO of the company. What are the skill set that you would suggest these software engineer they should acquire to equip themselves to be ready for this role? Because when you become the CEO, you have so much more responsibility. You pretty much have to wear 1,000 hats. What would you be advised the skills that they should acquire to prep them for this day?
So I would say one is, first of all, I think you need to have some kind of expertise in the domain that you're working on, which generally plays well with software engineers. And yes, you have a technical expertise, but you need to develop also the market expertise there, like understand how your technical ability can solve a real life problem. So focus on becoming a technical expert at that, but also becoming an expert at the product that you're building, understand how it solves people's problem. The second one would be about hiring. And that's one place where I've been very lucky to be at a startup when I started my career, which is, as part of a startup and as part of the growing startup, you have to hire people and you need to develop some ability to evaluate people and make sure that the people that you're bringing into your team are going to be the right people. And as a software engineer, if you have the opportunity to do interview and to be more involved into the interview process, it's something that you should do if you want at some point to become an entrepreneur, because you will create a network of people that you know. You will get muscle memory about what you're looking for into people and what works well also with you as a coworker or as a colleague for the future. So I think that's very important skill to have. Now, the other one is you need to, this is something maybe that I've also learned at Airbyte, is that I've also done it before. It's, you need to be comfortable talking to users and to customers to really understand and dig deep into your interview to understand what exactly is the root cause of their problem. If you just focus on like the surface problem, you will probably be building a product, but probably not the real product that they need. And so it's this ability to dig deep and to understand the fundamental issue that they are facing. So for data integration, for example, in my case, people would tell me, oh yes, I'm spending time building data integration or connectors. And so the question is now to understand, why do they have to build these connectors? Like, what kind of problem do they have? Like, how many time do they have to build these connectors? Who is using these connectors? And trying to get a landscape of the problem you're trying to solve, and having this ability to interview people. It's very important.
I love it. That's great advice, especially on both point of hiring and speaking to the user. Now, share with us more about your company, Airbyte. What is the story of this and the exponential growth that I read on the net? It's crazy. Tell us more about it.
It is crazy. So, you know, when I left my previous company, so I was really looking, I mean, I had a sense of a problem space, and John and I were brainstorming a lot of ideas. So that's when we started to set up this framework to evaluate an idea. Like, every time you have an idea, during the first 24 hours, you will feel that it's an amazing idea. Wait for 24 hours and you will realize that it's a dumb idea. Every single idea that you don't feel at dumb, maybe you should start putting more energy into it, maybe talking to people, et cetera. But we have a framework for evaluating idea. And beginning of 2020, we actually went through the YC program, Y Combinator. And we went into YC with the problem space in which we wanted to build a product. So it was about data integration. And while at YC, we really followed the extreme customer interviews idea. And every day we would go like through 5-10 calls sometime with people to really understand and go deep into the problem that they were facing. And we came up with an initial product. This one was very geared toward marketing. And at the time, it was January, February, COVID was not something that the US was too exposed to. But in March, it really started to hit the US. And at that point, everything started to shut down. Marketing budget got completely cut. And we realized that the product that we had built, we were having a lot of issues closing the deals. We had a ton of very good traction initially, but at that time, because there were no more marketing budget in front of us, it was very hard to sell. And that's when we realized that we were building a good to have. And I'm sure there are startups that are succeeding at selling a good to have. In John and my mind, what we wanted was really, we wanted to build a product that is a need to have. It basically powers your business. It enables your business to be better. And so we continued our search, and in May, we started to think about this open source platform for integration. And really in July, we decided, okay, let's dive into this idea. We had talked with as like 50 customers of existing solutions. They had exposed us all the problems that they had with the solutions they were paying for. And we said, okay, let's go for it. And we released the first version in the end of September. And since end of September, so it had like 6 connectors, only supported full refreshes. So the MVP of what we wanted to do. And today we have over 70 connectors available, and we had over 1,200 companies that have replicated data with Airbyte. And in the middle, we managed to raise a seed with Axel. So it's been going pretty quickly, and we have a huge community today that is helping us on building and maintaining these connectors, on giving us feedback about the product. And that's an idea that has come a long way since we started.
I love it. I think you just mentioned a couple things that I pick up that I want to dwell into that. The number one is you spoke about the going into the extreme case of interviewing user and talk to them and ask them about all the things that you are building. And I think this is something that very often the software engineer, the data analytic guys are not doing enough, even though in the very massive organization, sometimes they are not going enough and they are not doing enough to interviewing the people within the organization and ask the user, let alone the actual user outside of the company. So my question is, especially for those who have never been to the Y Combinator, but they have heard so much of it, what are the framework that you pick up from the YC in this particular space and from your experience about going to the LAN to interview your user? How do you entice them to spend time with you and speak with you instead of just building a Google form and then chuck it on Facebook? Hey, I need someone to answer a couple of questions. Would you share with us some of those things that you have done in that space?
Yeah, so that is actually something we've started to do before we started YC, because when we're investigating ideas, we're like trying to discard them, but we're also trying to validate or invalidate them with like external feedback. So one thing is you need to start by fixing yourself on an audience. And in our case, we really focused on, for the initial product, we focused a lot on marketing type of persona and users. And for like the Airbyte product, as we know it today, we really focused on data engineering. First, you start with people that you have in your network. These are going to give you some feedback. Sometimes you also want them to put them in a state of mind where they're going to give you brutal and honest feedback. You don't want people to be taking care of you. So you want an actual, like, this is a bad idea. You want to know about it. And after that, what we did was, and that's actually one of the strengths of John, my co-founder, is his ability to outreach people on LinkedIn. And you would be surprised to see how many people actually want to share their problem with you. And if you tell them about a potential solution, yes, you might have like 5% of the people you reach out to that are going to get back to you, but these 5% are real treasure for you and your idea. And so that's what we did. We just spent a ton of time having, like, going on LinkedIn, talking to people, like reaching out to them. Like, conversion was good. Sometimes it was bad, depending on how we're messaging people. But in the end, what matters is, were we able to get a 15 to 30 minute call with these people. And every time we have like a huge Google Drive with thousands of, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of Google Docs for every single one of these interviews. And from one interview to the next, what we're trying to do is to understand, like, what have we learned from the previous interview that we want to dig more on? So, and for example, at some point we're looking at how we also want to build a UI and how we want to explain the product. And for that, you want people to be able to project themselves into the product that you're building after you've started talking about their problems. And here we would use a lot of mock-up, trying to explain to them different concepts and see how that resonated with them and try to understand, like, if this product existed today, how would they be using it into their organization? Who would they have to talk to be able to use that project? And what kind of friction they would have internally? How would they be able to prioritize this product internally if they want to install it and use it? And these are all these little things. And you just, it's a ladder. Every time you learn something, you get to the next step. And you continue like that and you dig up until to a point where you forge yourself an intuition and you forge yourself the knowledge that let's do an MVP. Let's put that now in front of all these users that we've talked to in the past and see how they react. And that's exactly what we've done for Airbyte. With June, July, we've talked to between 50 and 60 companies and we learned about their problem. We noted everything. And then end of September, when we released the first version of Airbyte, we contacted all of them, the one that had answered to us, and we asked them, okay, this is Airbyte, this is the MVP, what do you think? And then we had the similar calls with the one that wanted to, that were okay to give us feedback, and we just continued the investigation with them. And today, because we have a community, we can actually reach out directly to our community to understand, like, what are the next features that we need to develop? What is missing? What is Airbyte weak at today? And what is it strong at? So it allows us to prioritize project better. And so I think now we have like a good amount, like a large amount of people that can actually help us build an amazing product.
And I think one of the things that make the Airbyte so distinctively different, and which is also the direction that you are trying to put Airbyte into, is about the open source and the community. Share with us the thought behind this direction and what made you and John to decide to go into this direction of the community and the open source then instead of full-fledged commercial software as a service.
Yeah, so that actually came from talking to users. And there are some of them are users today, some of them are waiting for additional feature. But back in July, what we did is we talked to people that were customers of Fivetran, of Stitch, of Matillion, all these ETL, ELT platforms. And we just wanted to see, okay, what do you think about the product that you're paying for today? How is it serving you? How is it not serving you? And what we realized, like 100% of the people that we talked to, they were paying for this product, but they were also rebuilding a pipeline on the side. So at that point, I think it's a matter of why, like trying to understand why they're building it. Why can't the existing less modern solution not helping them solve their problem? And that's when we realized that actually, if you want to build data integration right, it has to be an open product because data is so ubiquitous across every single organization that it's very hard for one single company to create connectors and to pull data from all these different places. It is physically impossible. But what you can do is, what if you can build an open product where people can actually contribute and customize to their need and allowing them to just pull this data from everywhere? And that's when like the open source idea came, which was, okay, the way today to bring people into your project is to make it open source, is to give them this framework that they can use and that they can use for free as well, which is because that's open source, they can decide to use it today. And how do you foster the community to build and to maintain these connectors? And that was really like why we went for the open source. That's the new modern way of doing data integration. It's going to be very hard for another company that is just building the connector internally, not sharing the code source, to be successful, I believe, in the future.
it reminded me of the code from, I don't know, was it from Sergey or is it from Larry from Google? I think one of them said that for the software to be distributed and adopted by so many people, it has got to be free. And then when they bought the Android and they just give it away for free, I think it seems like it is really the right direction to go for many reasons. So I think you guys are killing it. What is your advice in building the community, though? Because everyone or every company talks about they have their own community, they build community, they take care of their community. But I know how challenging it is and how difficult it is to build community from the ground up. Would you share with us some advice and tips in building really the real community?
Yeah, I think one thing that is helping us a lot is transparency. It's like we're like an open company at that point, which is every single one of our internal process is available online. We have a handbook, it's public. So we try to be as public as possible. And, you know, we have a Slack that we use and we share with the community. It is our Slack. This is the Slack that we own as the core employees of Airbyte. We're sharing the same one with the community. And every single conversation that we have between team members are open. Anyone can come onto our Slack, look at it, and see how we're building it. And I think that inspires a lot of confidence, especially when people are looking at, okay, what solution should I be using today? Should I pick like a Matillion or a Fivetran, or should I use like an open source, something that I can model to my own need? And seeing how the company works internally, I think inspires a lot of confidence into the product and into how we're doing things. I think that also the fact that our mission is about commoditizing data integration, it means that there is one role that we have, which is data connectors should always remain open source. They should never be behind a paywall. The day they start being hidden behind a paywall, then suddenly you're creating a disconnect between your community and the product that you're building. And that might hurt the community at that point. And what we want is to make sure that commoditizing means connectors are free. Of course, we're also a company. We need to make money one day or another. And at that point, it's more about what do we build on top of this connector that is going to add value to an organization or to a team. And being very transparent about how we think about it, I feel like inspires a lot of confidence from the people and the community. After that, we do a lot of content. We try to explain how we are building the company, what are our OKRs every quarter. We publish them publicly. Just recently, we published the slide deck that we've used to raise our seed. And this had a lot of that. Just, I think it inspires people to just see how we're doing. And at some point they stay because Airbyte and the product. So
I think you guys succeed very, very well in terms of telling the story. So that is really the great thing that you guys are doing. I want to go back before we dive into the deeper details about Airbyte, how people can use Airbyte and what Airbyte do and how they can use Airbyte to help with their data integration. I want to go back to the time in March 2020 when COVID hits, money dry up, and you and John realized that it's better you want to build something that people need to have instead of good or nice to have. Apart from John being so supportive in this journey, was there any one particular person that it was so supportive and about that transition and also the challenges that you guys were facing at that time?
So I think it was John, but it was also the team. We were working with three engineers that are still at Airbyte today. But it's basically, if you're building a company, you want to make sure that you're going to do everything you can to make it successful. So I think the day you see this signal that you're building a product that is not going to be successful, you have to make the hard choice. And at that point, it was, I was feeling it, John was feeling it, the team was feeling it. So I think we were all in agreement that this was not the right product to build. And at that point, we had also raised a pre-seed at that time and like started a seed round. And we owe it as well, not just to the team, but also to our investor to make sure that we are building and we are focusing on the right thing. And I would say like everybody was very supportive of it. It was just chaos at that point in everywhere in the world. So you had to adapt. I mean, if we were to continue in that direction, we knew we were going in a war. So we had to do something and to change something. So everybody was supportive of that. Our investor was supportive of that. Our team was supportive of that. Our families were supportive of that. Because if you're building the wrong product, you're going to be stressed. You're going to be unhappy. You're going to be worried. And this will also have an impact on your family and the people around you. So everybody is supportive of entrepreneur focusing on the right product.
Speaking of the investor, tell us about the good news. You and the team at the Airbuy just raised $5.2 million in seed funding and from various high-profile investors, including the co-founder of Segment, YC, and a few other really high-profile people.
Yeah, so at that point, what happened is when we released the MVP of Airbuy, and we had already put a few articles here and there to talk about the pivot and et cetera. So there were already some attention on what we were building with Airbuy. And the thing is, in the first months after we released Airbuy, we started to see like the beginning for huge growth. And we were also getting investors talking to us. And at that point, we started to discuss with Axel and with Amit Kumar, with our partner over there, we started to really brainstorm about like the ecosystem, like how does Airbuy fit everywhere? And in the end, we really had a very good connection on how he was thinking about open source, how we were thinking about open source, how we were thinking about the future of Airbuy. And yeah, and we, of course, Axel is an amazing partner. So is YC. And the fact that we are also able to work with other people that are expert in the industry, like, yeah, as you're saying, like the CTO of Segment, Oren Hoffman, and Charles from Cloudera, just people really understood like the value and the approach that we are taking and why a system has to be open when you're thinking of data integration and how it is the modern way of doing data integration today. So yeah, that went pretty fast, actually. It took 13 days to go from like starting to talk to VC to actually reach a term sheet for the seed. So it was a very fast moment. Intense, but fast.
That is amazing. So congratulations to that one. I know so many people would be envy of how quickly you can raise the seed in such a short amount of time. Now, I want to focus on the Airbuy. Now, tell the listener that we have. Now, many of the listeners, they work in the large corporate, whether it's the financial services company, government agency, or retail, etc. So who are the people Airbuy is built for, and what can they do with Airbuy?
Yeah, so basically, Airbuy is a data integration platform. It is open source, and it is built to address the new problematics or the new problems that the data world is facing. So if you think about what has happened over the past 5 years, you had Snowflake that became extremely successful. You have BigQuery that is also becoming extremely successful as well. You have all these warehouses and the way people are consuming data that has completely changed. The problem is, we have an amazing way to process the data and to query the data. We don't have an amazing way to get the data into these platforms. Today, what is happening is you have a lot of companies who are hiring data engineers, a lot of data engineers to actually build every single one of these connectors. Plus also what has happened over the past 5 years is the public has become more sensitive to all the new data regulation and what are companies doing with my data? We have CCPA, you have GDPR, like who has access to my data? That was one of the reasons why Airbuy is also open source. It is something that you can actually take and install onto your cloud, onto your VPC or into your infrastructure. And it means that now as a company, you have full control over your data. And as a data engineer, instead of building a connector and having to maintain it, you can just say, okay, I don't have to go through compliance. I just take Airbuy. I put it in my infrastructure. It's safe because the data is not leaving my infrastructure. And suddenly, instead of having to build and maintain connector, I can use some that are pre-built by the community. And this is very good for when you're thinking about financial, if when you're talking about health, when you're talking about government type of organization, where under no circumstance the data is going to leave their premise. So we have a very good angle here to reach out to these customers and to these users and have them use their bytes internally. And because we're targeting data engineers, we have like this bottom-up approach to adoption, where we start with one small use case of extract and loading data, and then we expand to more use cases in the organization. But yeah, it's really about empowering all these new systems, new warehouses, empowering all these new roles that now want to consume data from warehouses, from data lake, et cetera, et cetera.
I want to dwell a little bit deeper into this topic. So we have got all of these new tools in the data integration, data warehouse, but a lot of time, I mean, they're sitting in the cloud or on-prem or hybrid, et cetera, but all of these tools are purely and merely about building the data warehouse or where the data warehouse is sitting. At the same time, most of the organization are still very much focusing, obviously that depends on the area that they focus or where what they sit in. But a lot of time, all the data that people have within the organization and in their data warehouse is still the data coming from their core IT system. It is still coming from their core operating system, where the IT system they use to run their company and the business. So example, banking would have their own banking enterprise system to manage all the transactional account, you know, the transaction, etc. But I think what you are referring here or in the specific of the AirByte is more so of the bringing the external data coming into their own data engineering or their data integration ecosystem. So it would be, say, for example, the data from the Facebook advertising marketing platform. It would be the data from some of other company, like perhaps the Google advertising platform. And it is about integrating all this external data, what is equally important and required for some part and some of the department in this big organization, bringing all this data together and serve the needs of they need to serve the customer. Would that be the right way of describing this AirByte in terms of that particular use of the data integration? Because I just want to be sure and help explaining the different part and make sure we are not confusing with the data, the terminology here.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. So I think it's going to depend on the use case you have. And the way we're building AirByte is as a platform. And it is true that today, and it can also come from like the different type of organization that we've talked to, there is a vertical which is very geared toward customer data, like getting your data from Salesforce, getting your data from Facebook. But in the end, I think it's important to think of AirByte as a platform for moving data. We have actually
moving the external data into the internal data warehouse. Would that be?
So we're actually starting to see use cases where people want to move internal data using AirByte. So yes, we have connectors that are public that people are using to pull all this external data. But just recently, for example, we released a CDC connector because we have people who want to start pulling data from their internal system or their application databases into the warehouse. So we're starting to be pulled into this two direction. But because we're building AirByte more as a platform for data movements, so getting data from a source to a destination, whether it's an internal source or an external source, as long as the connector that you're building is complying to the protocol that we have, you can bring it through the platform into the warehouse. And it's more a matter of like use cases. So yes, we have a huge marketing use case, but we're starting to see also a huge internal use case. And we're starting to see some security use case of people who want to start auditing like information from Google Workspace or from Azure or from AWS, and they want to pull that information into warehouse so that they can start monitoring this type of data. So we're building it as a platform for just pull data wherever it is into your destination.
So I think it does make sense in terms as a platform of building all of this connector to pull the data externally into the internal data warehouse. I think in the earlier, I sort of like highlighted a little bit more of the marketing or the advertising. But like you were saying, it's more about pulling the external data, which is why then you have the Google Drive or perhaps the Dropbox, you know, all the sort of information. In terms of the internal connector, how would then be able to be replicated and reused once it's built as a connector? I think that's the direction that we would have to think hard then, because those external connector is going to be structured, is going to be based on their API that we sort of like know of. And a lot of time it can be reused and reused once it is built. But with the internal connector, how is that going to be reused and reused again? That is the question that we would have to think about. Especially for Airbyte.
No, that's a good question. And so we want to encourage people to publish connectors that can be reused. And, you know, when you think about extract and load, because you're removing transformation from the equation, you can basically publish this general purpose connector that everybody can use. It is true that when you're starting to think more about internal connectors, these are going to be very specific to your company, because maybe it's an API that only they know about, or maybe it's a system that they know about. But at that point, if you want to integrate that internal data, what you would have to do is you need to create a connector, you need to schedule that connector, you need to monitor that connector. And what we do actually is we can give you the ability to create your own internal connector. We don't need to know about it. And you can just plug them into Airbyte and they will work within Airbyte, and you will get monitoring, you will get scheduling, you will get all this information for free. It's just now when you're thinking about connection, you just need to think about the core code of your connector. You don't need to think about the infrastructure that is going to manage your connector. So we were starting to talk with companies who have like an internal Kafka, and they've built a layer on top of Kafka, but they're leveraging Airbyte for some use case, and they also want to leverage it to pull from that Kafka from their specific interface. And at that point, what they're doing is they're building an internal connector. They are using the public one for like public services, but they're building an internal one that they're just pushing internally, but that they are plugging into Airbyte directly. So it's more like you have like this central hub where all the data is flowing through. But yes, people, and now it's after that, it becomes the responsibility of the Airbyte project to just make it simpler and simpler to build connectors so that you can build them internally instead of starting from a blank page and starting a connector from scratch. So it's giving the tools to move data as well, not just providing already built connectors. It's how can you build connector fast?
I know you use the word or the terminology of connector very often. And in fact, that is how all the documentation on the website are being used. Whereas at the same time, I suspect that people are more familiar with other terminology like API and getting the data out. People perhaps are also talking about the data fabric. And this is getting the data. Walk us through what the differences of the data connectors in this case with API or data fabric, or are they indeed the same thing?
Yeah, I mean, connector is just an overarching concept of what is the glue that you need to connect to this silo of data. So it can be an API, it can be a database. And when you're talking about data fabrics, I think there are a lot of commonality between how we're thinking about Airbyte, which is like Airbyte is the entry point of the data in your data system. And what kind of feature you can put on top of it that are not just about the physical transport of your data, but also additional feature like data quality. How do you monitor that the data that you're importing is valid compared to what you've already imported in the past? How do you manage schema migration if the source data is changing format? How do you maybe start stamping your data or like adding probe to your data so that if you're using that data down the line, you can, and it's wrong data, how do you go back to where the data is coming from? So by being at the beginning of the value chain of data, there are a lot of additional feature that we can provide that is not just the physical movement of the data. So I think that's in general what data fabrics mean, which is everything that goes about how do you get the data into your place and every feature that is built on top of it. I would say we're pretty similar to the general definition of data fabric, but yeah, connector is really anything like the glue between Airbyte and the external system.
I love it, especially when you were talking about some of those features or the things that you can do down the track is about monitoring those things. Wouldn't you say those are your long-term vision for Airbyte? Or perhaps is much, much bigger than that, if that's okay. Share with us some of those long-term vision you have got for Airbyte.
Yeah, I mean, the long-term vision is we want to commoditize integration and ensure that Airbyte is ubiquitous in every data movement. So when you want to move data, whether it's like when it's like pulling data from somewhere, sending it somewhere else, you have something in Airbyte that can do it for you. And at that point, you don't have to think about the pipes in between. You just focus on just putting the pipes and the data flows. And in terms of when we're thinking about the products, like what are the additional features that this pipe need to have for you to actually trust that the data is moving correctly? And that's what we will be building, and that's what we will be building our open core model on, which is all these different features that your organization need.
Thank you, Michel. I love some of your use cases for the big corporate and how they can use it as a data infrastructure. Do you mind to elaborate a bit more on that, if that's okay?
Yeah, of course. So when we're working with enterprises, the way it happens today is we're really having this bottom-up approach where we're trying to solve the problem of engineers. And today we're working very hard on making sure that we can offer like the features that are necessary for enterprises to adopt Airbyte as a solution for their data needs. And that goes with like making sure that we're building the connector that are relevant to the size of their organization, making sure that we have the right controls and the right monitoring, the right auditing features in Airbyte. And that's something we're spending time on and to ensure that Airbyte can address the use case of enterprises today.
I love how some of these big corporate, they are taking it and putting it into their infrastructure and then collecting the external data. I always believe that it is about collecting and combining all this external data and make your internal data so much more powerful. Speaking of this feature, do you mind to share what are the features that you think that are missing and what sort of timeline they can be expecting, and hence it would be wise to revisit Airbyte again sometime down the track to have Airbyte in their data infrastructure?
So let me maybe just go back. So we have some of them that are using us today. It's just that it's a very localized use case. It's not like the global hub that everybody can be using. So we have some engineers in this large organization that have started to address one use case with Airbyte. Now to have like a more widespread use across the company, I think what we need is we need to have SSO, for example. We need to have role and access management. We need to, and this is something we're actively working on today. And I would say probably like end of Q2, maybe beginning of Q3, we'll start to see these features available. We need to probably get more auditing as well, like who is changing configuration, where is the data going, how do you alert around what's happening within Airbyte. So these are features that we need to continue to iterate on for larger organizations. And then, of course, and so this we have contributors who are starting to work on it, is connectors that are specific to the enterprise software. So in here, you have like, you have SAP, you have ServiceNow, you have all these different software that we need to build connector for so that they like larger enterprise can start pulling data from these systems. And this is something we're working on at the moment, like ramping up these connectors and this family of enterprise connectors.
Love it. Now, your key competitors are FiveTran or Stitch Data. What makes Airbyte different from these data integration tools?
So I would say, first of all, the openness, meaning when we talked to Stitch Data and FiveTran customers a few months ago, everybody was rebuilding connectors on the side because the one that they had were not working the way they needed it to be or needed them to be. And also because some connector was simply missing. And it's very hard for one single company to just address the long tail of connectors. So that's a big deal. And that's why we're building Airbyte as an open product. So to make sure that people can bring their own connectors, or if there is a connector that exists, they can also tweak it to their own need. The other piece was like the pricing, which, because they are like a SaaS solution, they basically have to price on the volume of data that is transiting through their pipes. And in general, with data, that's counterproductive, because what we see with data is you might have like exponentially growing data, but the insight that you will get is linearly or logarithmic. But you need the whole data to make decision and to get the right insight. So pricing should not go in the same direction.
In terms of the pricing, how do you price for the people who want an upgraded version of the Airbyte? And how do you charge them? How do you make money?
Yeah. So first of all, there is a philosophy behind how we think about pricing. And 2021 is really focused on the community edition and make sure that we build a huge user base of Airbyte and we build a community. Now, when we think about pricing, what is going to give value to one individual should remain free. What brings value to an organization is where we charge. So that's how we think about pricing. Now, for the different pilots that we have, we generally charge, it's more like a one-off type of contracts where we charge on SLAs and support. So that is something that people who are actually installing Airbyte to power their system want to have some guarantee around it. And that's what we do. But the focus today is not on the revenue making piece. It is going to be, but right now it's really about making sure that we're building the right product and that we're addressing a real problem.
I love it. One final question before we conclude the move on to the final part is, I think there's one thing when I was doing the research and prepare for this interview, you speak a lot about long tail. What exactly do you mean by long tail, especially for the listener who haven't had a time to go and research this space or this topic?
Yeah. So when we talk about long tail, what it means is if you're looking at an organization, they might be using like 50, 60, 100 different tools, whether it's for marketing, whether it's for finance, whether it's for engineering, DevOps, et cetera, et cetera. So you have all this data that is scattered across so many systems. And when you look at existing solutions today, in general, they have like 100, 150 integration. I can bet you that you will never get 100% coverage of what you're looking for. And that's what long tail is all these products that exist that are not covered by existing solution, but that, so because of that, you might be missing out on the data, or you might just build it internally. And we want to make sure that with the help of the community, we can actually address this long tail so that when you install Airbyte, you have access to these thousands of different connectors. Our goal is to get to 200, between 200 and 300 by the end of the year. You have access to all of these connectors. And with the community growing, we can continue to build more and more of these connectors, so that every single one of your use case can be addressed from one platform with the help of the community.
Amazing. I think the power of the community is always so strong. Thank you so much, Michel, for all of these talking about Airbyte and also the integration. I'm going to ask you two questions that I always ask my guests in concluding the interview. Number one is, what is your most important first principle?
So when I think about Airbyte, is it just works. So we want to optimize for like the speed of people to experiment, like the benefit that they will get from Airbyte. And we want to limit how much, we want to just make it work in, and that's about like the long tail. It's like every use case that you have, it should work with Airbyte. Every volume of data that you have, it should work with Airbyte, because our goal is facilitating and being ubiquitous for data movement. So it has to work. We're putting all our engineering effort, all our product effort into making sure that it just works. And yes, we're still new, so I'm sure there are things that are going to break, but we will work hard to make sure that it just works. So that's my first principle today.
I love it. What is one book that you have read and thought it would have been better for your younger self to have?
Yeah, so that might sound like a very trivial answer, but I really love the book like High Output Management from Andy Grove, so former CEO of Intel. I think it is one of the best book. I mean, it's an old book, so some things might need to be updated a bit, but fundamentally, the book is extremely good at expressing what it means to build a company, to build a team, and how do you establish all the processes that govern your organization? How do you measure the right thing to make sure that you're allocating your time, your money, and your people on the right problems? And I think it's, I hope I had knew about that book when I was 18. I think it would have changed my perception of how organization work in general and what you should be thinking about when you're building a team and everything. But I read it, so I got the learnings.
I love it. Thank you so much, Michel, again, to share with us about all this data integration, how to bring all of these external data. I think what I really especially love about is how you build a community and how you think about commoditize the data integration and making sure every single data that someone ever need will be able to be available. I often think that by combining the data and making all this transparency is what makes the world better. So thank you so much for that one.
Thank you. It was great to be able to talk about LiveRamp and what we're doing and how we're doing it. It's part of our openness about the product and the company.
Thank you so much.